Greetings. My name is Pastor Djenaba Akida, coming to you from Shrine of the Black Madonna number 10 in Houston, Texas. Thank you for joining us this morning. I want to thank you for sharing your time with us. Your time is valuable, and we consider it an honor to have you a part of our fellowship. Here at the Shrine, we are a revolutionary best self movement that's dedicated to the upliftment, enlightenment, and empowerment of Black people. We believe that there is nothing more sacred than the liberation of Black people. For the past 3 weeks, we focused on the celebration of Pan-African Women's History Month. We tell her story to pay tribute to the countless sheroes and foremothers who have allowed us to survive and thrive through their contributions and their sacrifices. We told her story because for far too long, her story has been left out and overlooked. And I ask you, how can we call ourselves fully educated, fully enlightened, fully woke, if we only know part of the story? We need to know the whole story to understand how we got over. We need to know the whole story to appreciate the stony road we trod. We need to know the whole story to understand why life for me ain't been no crystal stair. We need to know the whole story so that we can be continually encouraged and that we can build upon our great legacy. Our work is not done because there are accomplishments yet to be revealed. And I emphasize our work because each of us has the ability to find and then spread this great news about the sisters who have done so many wonderful things for us. And when we find those stories, while we should treasure them, we must also teach them her story. Today I want to take a few minutes to talk about reclaiming our time. Our scripture comes from Ecclesiastes 3 verses 1 and 6, and it reads, "There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away." I use as my text, a time to keep. Now, as we've been examining Ecclesiastes this past few weeks, we recognize that it's a part of the wisdom books of the Old Testament, and that these wisdom books give us certain eternal truths. Because even though the books were written to an African community thousands of years ago, we can still provide or get understanding about what the writer was grappling with. He was looking at life's dilemma, that life's journey contains both obstacles and opportunities. Now, opportunities are preferred because they provide pathways to fulfill our life's purpose. And quiet as this kept, each of our lives has purpose. What we do to accomplish that purpose, to reach that purpose, to fulfill that purpose, that's what brings meaning to our existence. And I know it's easy to get caught up in the chaos and the confusion and negativity and the doubt that fills and occupies our space. So we have to often remind ourselves that our lives do indeed have purpose. See, each of us was given inherent qualities and gifts by God, and they're just there waiting to be discovered. And not just discover, but unleash. So whether you've had thoughts of becoming a doctor, a healer, or creating great recipes or great masterpieces, whatever those urgings, we have to learn how to listen to that inner voice and to reach our purpose. The ancestors that we've been talking about for the past few weeks, they did not live a life that was free of obstacles, but they used the opportunity that they had to make life better. They understood that waiting around for somebody else was not the answer. What I'm trying to tell somebody is, there is a time for everything. So in that scripture, it talks about a time to keep, a time to lose. Now, what I would suggest is that we lose these obstacles, or our obsession with obstacles, because I know we live in a world where it seems like no matter how brilliant we are, how well-intentioned we are, how hard-working we are, that we are confronted with obstacles. You know, just because you feel good doesn't mean you're gonna have a good time. So what do we do with this time? Now, I know many people are obsessed with the obstacles. We get caught up in the what ifs and the not nows rather than the yes, we can do it right now. But when we get preoccupied with these obstacles, no matter how large, no matter how small, they disrupt our progress and our growth. So the writer is trying to tell us that there's a time for everything. There's a time to keep. And I know sometimes we get so caught up in time that we think that time doesn't belong to us. Just look at now. We're in daylight saving time. Somebody tells us what time to start the day, what time to start the evening. But we have to recognize that we have the ability to use the time. And I know you say, wait a minute, time belongs to no one. Haven't you ever heard that we live on borrowed time? I want you to pray with me for a minute this morning. I contend that each of us has been blessed with time. From the moment we take our first breath until we take that last gasp, we have time. Or what our sister Abel referred to last week so brilliantly is that Kairos moment of opportunity. We have the ability to make an impact not only on our lives, but the lives of our family and the lives of our community. What am I getting at? We have the ability to take the time and make it work for our benefit. And that's what our ancestors did. Now I know many are saying, we can't do it now. Now is not the time. How many times have we heard that? Now is not the time. We need to wait. Don't you realize what's going on? Don't you realize that we're in the midst of a pandemic? I would like to ask you, which pandemic are you talking about? Is it the pandemic that began in 1619 that includes more than 400 years of brutal enslavement and exploitation of our ancestors? That pandemic, that plague that has for more than 20 generations left the effects of a post-traumatic slave syndrome, described by Michelle Alexander in her book, The New Jim Crow, creates in us a vacant esteem. Not a low self-esteem, but a vacant esteem where we don't even find value in ourselves and our families or our communities because we who were once a proud and glorious people have been reduced to levels of humiliation, degradation, and self-destructive behavior. Maybe it's the pandemic of systemic racism that has intentionally, consistently, and consciously hindered the possibility or the probability of our advancement in this society. We built this country, but we can't enjoy it. And it's not by accident that we have been marginalized and isolated from the opportunities. You ain't got me started now. Which pandemic is it? Is it the pandemic of COVID-19 that has disproportionately affected our community? That has revealed the starking differences and the vulnerability of the lack of health in our community, lack of proper resources to medical care, the food apartheid, the inability to have access to fresh foods, not to mention the uncertainty that has come out of it because we're hesitant to trust scientific methods, not because we don't trust the message, but we don't trust the messenger. Is that the pandemic you're talking about? Which pandemic is it? Is it the pandemic of institutionalized sanctioned killing of our unarmed brothers and sisters that has shortened their lifespans and has created constant trauma and fear in our lives? Let's just take a minute. Think back on this past year. During 2020 alone, we experienced in February the murder of Ahmaud Arbery. In March, the killing of Breonna Taylor. In May, the execution of George Floyd. In June, the lives of Rashard Brooks and Elijah McCain were taken away. And then more salt was poured on our wounds when we witnessed the inhumane treatment of Brittany Gilliam when she was taking a fun day with her nieces and her child, when they were all handcuffed and placed on the ground for suspicion of driving in a stolen car. Her baby was only 6 years old. Those are just some of the things that we've had to deal with. So we've had these obstacles. And you may say the clear thinking person would just say, you know what, now's not the time. But obstacles can be overcome. Obstacles can be defeated. Obstacles can be worked through. We can't discount the fact that our ancestors had more obstacles than we face. But I'm reminded by the scripture in Exodus 3 and 7 that reads, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. So I come down to deliver them. And then when it gets to verse 10, it says, come now, therefore, I send you, Moses, to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. See, in spite of the obstacles, in spite of the challenges, the scripture tells us that we have an ever-present hope and power that comes not from man, but from God. Moses got strength from God, and he was able to go and to bring the children of Israel out. So what does that mean? We got to keep on keeping on. We got to keep on pushing. It reminds me of that song by Curtis Mayfield and the Impressions. The song says, keep on pushing. We can't stop now. Move up a little higher. Some way, somehow. Because I've got my strength. And then there was a line that I had almost forgotten about. It says, it doesn't make sense not to keep on pushing. As difficult as it may appear, we are endowed with a spirit of resistance that won't let us sit idly by. It is a revolutionary Holy Spirit that will not long permit men to endure injustice, nor to wear the shackles of bondage in the rage of the powerless when they struggle to be free, and in the violence and conflict which even now threatens to level the hills and the mountains. And such an example was found in a sister who was born in a time when black people's spirit were being constantly silent, and particularly the spirit of black women. Her name is Drusilla Dungy Houston. She was born in 1876, and her family, though starting off in Harpers Ferry, West Virginia, traveled to Oklahoma, where they became a part of an established group of wealthy black people. She didn't attend college herself, but she acquired the skills and knowledge from other black educators and her self-study. And it said that she, at one point, was able to speak 4 different languages. She herself dedicated her life to educate black children. She created clubs and schools and organizations to uplift black people. Her voice was a voice that spoke out against the lynchings and the riots that were affecting our people at the time. She wrote over 3,000 editorials refuting lynching, refuting the racist tendencies that were being depicted upon black people at that time. Even in 1915, when the movie The Birth of a Nation came out, where they were glorifying the Klans, she wrote her own story talking about the maddened mob, where she refuted that American life was docile and happy. But later on, she even began to write literary works from a historical perspective. She wrote a book called The Wonderful Ethiopians of the Ancient Kushite Empire. It took her 25 years, but this book was published in 1926. And her purpose was to correct the distortions in the historical record of ancient African people and their descendants worldwide. She was a forerunner of Pan-Africanism. She was a forerunner of the Black Studies movement. And even though threats were made upon her and her family's life, she continued to push forward, and she remained active until her death in 1941. But we don't necessarily hear about Drusilla Dungy Houston, so I'm calling out her name because she was endowed with that spirit of resistance. That same spirit that's available to us today, if we would just open ourselves to that power, that divinity, unleashing that power within. And that's what the PAOCC is doing when we use our different processes to help us to create a life that's free of domination and fear. It gives us insight to allow us to see beyond the right now to envision the possibilities of tomorrow. That's why our participation in Lent is so important. You see, the Lenten season, that 40-day period that began on Ash Wednesday and ends on Easter, it gives us a focused opportunity. We're given the space to rearrange our spiritual priorities, where we're not growling in fear, but we're allowing ourselves to be used to fulfill God's calling. So when we use those ancient practices of meditation, of fasting and prayer, these are not just futile exercises, but they are essential to assisting us in opening the pathways of our inner divinity. They give us the power of revolutionary enlightenment. So we do it because we cannot allow others to continue to block our opportunities to prosper. We do it because we cannot allow others to dictate what our time looks like. We do it because we cannot allow others to dominate our minds with lies and distortions. Brothers and sisters, we do it because we must move forward. We must reclaim our time. And you say, why do you have to talk about reclaiming our time? You know, I'm reminded of the situation where Congresswoman Maxine Waters, who is a fierce proponent for Black equality, she was in a congressional hearing and people were trying to monopolize her time. They were trying to get her off track. And every time they would try to go off the tangent, she was like, I reclaim my time.
The time belongs to the general.
I contend that we have been stifled in our progress much too long. Let's reclaim our time. We want to reclaim our time like our sister Harriet, who refused to live her entire life as an enslaved woman. She reclaimed her time. We reclaim our time like Amy Jocks Garvey, who even after her husband was deported, published his works, The Opinions of Marcus Garvey. We reclaim our time like Mary McLeod Bethune or Rosa Parks or Fannie Lou Hamer. I want to reclaim my time like my great-grandmother, Minnie Thomas, who, when I was a toddler, would grab me as I was trying to run outside and tell me, when I was your age, girl, I was a slave. I want to reclaim my time like my grandmother Sophronia Hutchinson, who although she couldn't read and write as well, she made sure that I could. I want to reclaim my time like my mother Marion White, who taught me what it meant to learn and serve others. And I know you as well have people in your life who reclaim their time. We owe it to them, and we owe it to ourselves and to our future generations not to stop. Not to give up, not to settle. See, now is not the time for us to be lulled into a complacency. I know you may say, well, you know what? Our candidate was successful. The struggle is over. That's not the case. Just because something is coming in the mail doesn't mean the struggle is over. Just because a law gets passed does not mean the struggle is over. We have to reclaim our time. It's our time. That means we have the power. We have to take inventory, not just on what we've done in the past, but what we can continue to do to reach our fullest potential. Because in the words of our beloved founder, Jeremoji Abebe Hajiman, we are not saved once, but many times. This is our time. We got to use it to inspire. This is our time. We've got to use it to uplift. This is our time. Reclaim our time. Let's reclaim our time. Amen and ashe.